Hey YouTubers, Craig here. I wanted to make a video today and explain how you can treat your cluster headache with vitamin D3 and its cofactors. Now, my background into this is that I'm not a doctor, and I should probably state right here that this is not medical advice. I'm not qualified to give it, but I tell you what, from the perspective of someone that suffered from cluster headache since 2013, when I found vitamin D3 in 2015, I have not had another attack since. And I've since helped heaps of people get onto this regimen, and they've had similar results for both cluster headache and migraine. So with that out of the way, it's a personal story about how vitamin D3 has been instrumental in allowing me to treat my cluster headache. And so, as I mentioned, I started to get cluster headache in 2013, in November. It was very specific, the date. I remember it, November the 7th, 2013. The first time you get one of these things, honestly, you feel like that's it, then and there, aneurysm, and it's all over. But no, you live to face another attack and another attack and another attack. So I really struggled through 2013. It was a hard year, and I didn't really see any end in sight. In 2015, I got diagnosed. I saw a neurologist. That neurologist was pretty switched on and mentioned to me that vitamin D3 may be able to help with cluster headache, but couldn't really give me too much more information than that. Bring on the vitamin D3 regimen that I found in 2015. And within 8 days of starting this regimen, the attacks stopped. And so I feel a obligation to share it with people. So what is it? I'm going to bring it up on the screen now. The vitamin D3 anti-inflammatory regimen for cluster headache and migraine. As of 2017, when this was last updated, there are a number of things on there. First and foremost, vitamin D3 at 10,000 international units a day, or adjusted to keep serum around 80 nanograms per milliliter. And we'll talk about that shortly. And then vitamin D3's cofactors, namely omega-3 fish oil, calcium, magnesium, vitamin K2 as either MK4 or MK7, vitamin A, vitamin B50 or B50 complex, zinc, and boron. Now, that's what it is. A little bit more about who came up with this thing. Now, his name, to many of the people that know him, is Batch. That's his call sign. His name is Pete Batchelor. Now, he's a retired Navy fighter pilot, and he's got a degree in zoology, biochemistry, and physics. Beyond that, he is the most genuine, beautiful man, and I have so much gratitude and thanks towards this guy, like you would not believe. So, you know, that's where I'm at. That's Pete. He designed this thing. Now, I mentioned I got the headaches in 2013, and so why didn't I try the vitamin D3 regimen sooner than I did? Well, there are a couple of reasons. First and foremost, it just sounded really complicated. I looked at that list. I didn't really know where to start, what to take, where to buy it, that kind of thing. The second thing was vitamins, right? And I think that's society's general point of view towards these things. A supermarket aisle where you waste your money. But as I've come to find out, that's certainly not the case. But that's the misconception that I had about vitamin D3 going into this. And then the second thing was, apart from a neurologist that had suggested vitamin D, my doctor just wasn't on board. Like most health professionals, anyone you meet, you mention vitamin D, well, they don't even hear the D part. They just completely switch off at vitamin, which I think is an absolute shame, having walked, you know, and come full circle with using vitamin D as a treatment option. So there you go. Those are the three reasons why I didn't get onto this sooner. Now, where do you get it? And I think this was one of the really hard things about being in New Zealand is that we have some legislation by our governing body, MedSafe, that says vitamin D3 can only be sold at a maximum dose of 1,000 international units or 1,000 IU without a prescription, which is an absolute crying shame. So I went to pharmacy with that list that I showed you earlier, and they just give you a look of, you're a desperate person trying to, and they help you as best they can. But evidently it was someone that suggested, look, if you want to buy the right things, then you can buy them internationally on iHerb. And that's what I've been doing since 2015. Now, before I pull up on screen the list of items that I buy from iHerb to satisfy all of the items that you saw in the vitamin D3 regimen list of cofactors, was that you can get vitamin D3 in 50,000 international unit capsules or gel capsules on prescription from your doctor, and they come in packs of 12. They are subsidized in New Zealand. I'm not sure about other parts around the world, but it's certainly worthwhile keeping that in mind, and we'll come to the reason why when we start talking about loading dose. But here's the list of stuff that I buy from iHerb, and this constitutes everything that you need in order to start the vitamin D3 regimen. So of the 8 or 9 items that were listed, here they are broken down into 6 pills, starting with the fish oil, the omega-3 complex, the B vitamin, the B50 complex, that's a multivitamin is next. And you can use any multivitamin so long as it contains the boron, zinc, calcium, and vitamin A retinol. Next is the vitamin K2, followed by the vitamin D3, also known as cholecalciferol. Note the strength or dosage on that per capsule is 10,000 international units or IUs, so just perfect for the vitamin D3 regimen. And the last item on there is magnesium. And so there you go. So that's what I buy. And that'll do you for a while. In terms of cost, we'll get on to looking at kind of what a cost per dose looks like to use the regimen in a second. But before we do, I've mentioned 10,000 and 50,000 international units or IUs. But it's important to move on to talking about how levels are described in terms of how much of vitamin D3 you've got in your tank, or commonly referred to as your 25-OHD serum. You will have recalled from earlier, the target serum for the vitamin D3 regimen is 80 nanograms per milliliter. There is a range of efficacy from 80 to 120 nanograms per milliliter. Well, what's a nanogram per milliliter, and why do you need to be careful? Because in America, a vitamin D3 test that you will get done at a laboratory is measured in nanograms per milliliter. And so if you got your test in America and you're looking at the vitamin D3 regimen that's saying you need to be at 80 to 100 nanograms per milliliter, then you can read that test verbatim and know that you can base your supplementation on those two figures. However, if you're in New Zealand, I believe Australia, United Kingdom, a lab test will be given in what's referred to as nanomoles per litre, and it's a multiplication factor of 2.5. So without confusing it too much, if you're in America and your lab said 100 nanograms per milliliter, well, in New Zealand, that would be reading 2.5 times that to give a nanomol per liter reading of 250 nanomoles per liter. Vice versa, if you're in New Zealand and you want to work out what your nanogram per milliliter serum value is, then you would just divide your lab result in nanomoles per liter by 2.5, and you'll get your nanograms per milliliter. But there is a really helpful tool available online. I will have the link below in the comments, and it's just a screenshot coming up for you now. But in terms of levels for the vitamin D3 anti-inflammatory regimen and what the goal or the aim is, the aim is to elevate your vitamin D3 to at least 80 nanograms per milliliter. And some folks require slightly more, as I said, perhaps 100 or perhaps 120 nanograms per milliliter in order for the attacks and the headaches to stop. Now, I just wanted to stop and note that there are other doctors and therapists out there that have similar regimens. For example, Stasha Gomanak's Sleep Right course aims for a serum of 80 nanograms per milliliter, or between 60 and 80. Judson Somerville's The Optimal Dose in his book talks about a level slightly higher than this, between 100 and 150. And the Combria protocol is even slightly higher than that, at around 150 nanograms per milliliter. Pete or Corsine Batch isn't the only one talking about dosing vitamin D3 at these kind of levels. In terms of what the recent and current research that's coming out, if you read articles on PubMed and the National Institute of Health, they're all talking about a level which is optimal now, looking like around 50 to 80 nanograms per milliliter. It's all really interesting that traditionally levels have been set far lower than this, but the new research is starting to show that there's some real benefit aside from treating cluster headache at having a higher vitamin D3 level. So anyway, how do you take it once you've ordered the stuff from iHerb and it arrives? And what does that look like? So firstly, lab testing. You want to get ideally your labs done before you start supplementing. If you do that, then you have a really good idea of where your baseline level is at. And having done a variety of tests with people in my family life at the moment and in recent times, I can tell you that most people have come in between as low as eight nanograms per milliliter and as high as 24 nanograms per milliliter if they have not been taking vitamin D. And in actual fact, one or two people have been supplementing at 1000 IU vitamin D and their levels have still been very low and come out as deficient. So first and foremost, it is a really good idea to get your labs done at a local lab test, organize it through your doctor. If your doctor's not on board, go and find one that will listen and order you the lab test. If it's a case of needing to pay for the lab test, in New Zealand, you can go into a local clinic and you can order it. It costs you about $70, or you can buy a D3Me self-test, which you can do by pricking your finger at home and using your smartphone to get your level. Either way you do it, get your level at baseline, and then you know where you're at, and you'll soon be able to work out how far you are away from that 80 to 100 nanograms per milliliter where the attacks will stop. So presumably, like most people, you get your first lab test, you're low, like the other people that I've mentioned that have recently had their labs done, and so you know you need to start taking vitamin D3 in order to get to that level where the attacks just will stop. Righto, so what does that look like? Well, in order to get from a low level to a high level, and do that relatively promptly so that you don't need to wait months before it starts working, that's when you would take a loading dose. So you receive your supplements And for the first 12 days, you would do, and I'm bringing it up on the screen just to make it really crystal clear, you would take five of those 10,000 IU vitamin D3 tablets, along with one of each of the other tablets. And after 12 days, if you had done that every single day, you would have taken roughly, or you would have taken exactly 600,000 international units of vitamin D3, and you would have taken one of each of those pills every single day. And at that range and at that level of dosing, you should have elevated your level to 80 nanograms per milliliter. Most people will note that they see a therapeutic effect after they've taken around their 400,000th international unit of vitamin D3. At least for me, on day 8, that's when the magic happened and they stopped. And I hugged my wife and like, I'll tear up talking about it because you don't know. Yeah, I am, right? And I'm not going to edit this out, right? Because you know, you will see this and you'll realize how genuine. It was a really, really hard time with the attacks. Like, I looked at my wife at times, I said, I'm just not tough enough. I can't get through this. And amongst the attacks, and man, that was a real dark time. And on the 8th day, that was like, it was gone. I'm just not going to edit this out because it just speaks to how hard the condition is to live with, and how much thanks I have that fate brought Pete and the vitamin D3 regimen into my life. Like, it's really that simple. Anyway, we're talking about the maintenance dose. And so on the 8th day, it would have been the 400,000th IU, things changed for me and it looked up. And for most people, it's between day 8 and day 12 that they see therapeutic effects, where the headaches either stop or they lessen and the attacks are less severe. So on the 13th day, that's when you would switch up. On the loading dose, it has been revised in recent times so that instead of what I've just shown you up on the screen now, you can do this over 6 days. And I know it's a lot of pills per day, but if you're doing the loading dose over 6 days, it just means your level is going to rise quicker and you're going to see the therapeutic effects faster. But so over 6 days, it would look like 10,000 IU units or pills per day to make 100,000 units or 600,000 units over 6 days. No problem at all. Completely safe. So you've either finished your 6 days or your 12 days and you're moving on to your maintenance dose. And again, I'm going to bring it up on the screen now. This is exactly what the maintenance dose looks like. It's exactly the same as the loading dose, apart from you're reducing your vitamin D3 intake to a daily amount of 10,000 international units. Now, after this, you would take that maintenance dose forevermore, and for at least until you were still in cluster headache cycle. In terms of getting your levels tested again, I would recommend that you wait 4 weeks from having stopped the loading dose and moved on to maintenance. So long as you're seeing a therapeutic effect, keep on going. And then go and get your level tested at that 4 week mark after you've been on maintenance. And based on that serum level, if you're a little bit high above the kind of that range of 80 to 120 nanograms per milliliter, you can then maybe adjust the regimen to take 10,000 international units 6 days a week and have Sundays off, for example. And so that would be my testing strategy. In terms of onward testing, absolutely. And I'll get on to the reason why I would recommend that on the offset and in continuation. Now, moving on to the different forms of vitamin D. So do not let your doctor give you vitamin D2. D2 is not for humans. Humans make vitamin D3 in their skin, and we convert that vitamin into a hormone called calcitriol. I'm not going to get into the science behind it. Suffice to say, vitamin D2 or ergocalciferol is designed for the things that live in the nighttime, like mice, for example. Mushrooms make it, plants make it, humans make vitamin D3. If you're going to supplement, make sure you reach for the vitamin D3. Now, in terms of vitamin D3 and risk, it's a really good question, and so something I think I, you know, it's relative to address it. Risk is minimal, really is. Now, I say that on the back of suggesting that if you have a comorbidity or another health condition, then absolutely discuss dosing with your doctor. But in terms of the levels and the amount of D3 that we're talking about taking, very, very safe from the lens of toxicity. Now, the risk associated with taking too much vitamin D is that you increase your level of blood calcium outside of a safe range. And what I would like to bring up on screen now is Pete's lab test. Now, Pete has been very, very thorough in getting his labs done on a very regular basis. And so what you can see here is that based on a lab test of 294 nanograms per milliliter, yes, that's right, 294, which is three times what we're talking about, only at that level did Pete's calcium almost move into the red zone and out of safe normal reference range. Similarly, the parathyroid hormone had tanked almost out of safe reference range, but not quite. It was at this point that his doctor called and said, hey, stop taking the vitamin D, you're reaching toxic levels. Now, I say it again, toxicity does not occur until you take a lot of vitamin D3, much more than what we're talking about here. So in reference to toxicity, very, very safe. In terms of risk associated inversely with low vitamin D, there isn't many modern illnesses now that are not being shown to be correlated with low vitamin D deficiency. I think the medical world is trying to answer the question of, is the correlation and connection between low vitamin D and an increase in risk associated with disease increase correlative or causative? For example, does low vitamin D serum cause a plethora and a range of illness, or as an offshoot of having one of these illnesses, do you have a low vitamin D level? Well, I can tell you my mind is very certainly made up on the subject, and I know that with the amount of literature and study being done on literally every illness that you can think of in vitamin D, the truth is certain to come out in the very near future. Now, at this point, up on screen is a website that I've frequented, and I'll talk more about shortly, but Vitamin D Wiki is where the Vitamin D Regimen is hosted, and it's a great resource for anyone wanting to learn about anything vitamin D related, from Alzheimer's to vitamin D in pets. It's all there. In one place, a website hosted by a gentleman by the name of Henry Lahore. Now, in terms of vitamin D levels and supplementing and conditions that may affect your ability to increase your level, there are a couple of things to think about here. And look, I'm by no means an expert, but what I do understand is that when vitamin D is supplemented, or when your skin converts it, it needs to go through a process where an enzyme in both your liver and in your kidney give hydroxylate or metabolize vitamin D into an active hormonal metabolite. Now, the two enzymes that are expressed in both the in the kidney and in the liver are subject to a genetic polymorphism that can affect the body's ability to then make those conversions, i.e. metabolize vitamin D into its active form. And so I would suggest checking out Dr. Rhonda Patrick's website, Found My Fitness. She has a testing service, and you can learn more information about that on her website. As I say, I'm not an expert. Gallbladder removal, which impacts bile production and the ability of the body to break down fats on ingestion, because vitamin D is a fat soluble vitamin. If you've had your gallbladder removed, then you really should consider taking a sublingual form of vitamin D3, for example, vitamin D3 drops, instead of the capsules which you need to metabolize. Parathyroid disease can affect your ability to convert vitamin D3 into its active metabolite or final metabolite calcitriol. Those people that are overweight and obese need more vitamin D3 to increase their levels than someone that is not obese. And so that's something to think about as well. Aside from that, your vitamin D3 serum will change throughout the year based on where you live, because of course it's the sunlight vitamin, and in the middle of winter there isn't a lot of UVB coming through during the days in order for your skin to metabolize the sunlight into vitamin D. And of course, if you're like me and you're covered and clothes, then well, you can only but understand how that impacts your body's ability or your skin's ability to make this hormone, and alludes you to the reason as to why many of us, most of us, I'm going to say, are now deficient. So that's some things to think about there in relation to vitamin D supplementing and other health conditions that may impact your ability to supplement and elevate your level. Something again to talk to your doctor about. In terms of using vitamin D3 alongside other treatments for cluster headache and migraine, yes. So this is the real beauty about vitamin D3. You can start taking it alongside the other medications you're taking for this condition. When I say that, I'm talking about triptan medication, for example, Maxalt and sumatriptan. I'm talking about prednisone and other steroids or anti-inflammatories. I'm talking about other treatments that specifically cluster headaches use, like LSD and magic mushrooms and other tryptamines like DMT. Yes, you can take the vitamin D3 regimen alongside that as a conjunctive kind of approach. And lastly, another one that springs to mind, if you're taking verapamil or lithium, then again, no problem to start supplementing that with the vitamin D3 regimen. So in terms of when to take the regimen, it's a really good question. And I said just before that vitamin D3, amongst a couple of the other vitamins like A, E, K, are fat-soluble vitamins. And what that means is that in terms of when you should take them with your largest meal of the day, and that will ensure the best absorption possible. Now, there is some school of thought in and around breaking up some of those things to take them separately. Again, I haven't read the data on that, so I really can't be of too much help in explaining that. In terms of efficacy, now, this is the good news. In terms of how many people does it work for, over 80% of sufferers. In actual fact, I think at last poll, for those people that took the regimen, followed it to the letter, for example, did the loading dose and did the maintenance dose and got their labs checked, in the mid-80s, so mid to high 80%, which is not too bad. In terms of those that it didn't work for, well, there could be numerous reasons for which we've already kind of alluded to in this video, from getting the lab levels confused to not doing a loading dose, to taking too small amount of vitamin D, D3, all of those can contribute to the vitamin D3 regimen not working. And so what I would say is, like, read the regimen and follow the instructions to the T to give yourself the best chance of getting a similar result to what I did. So that's efficacy. And in terms of feedback from other sufferers, so, you know, for myself, I'm sure you can see how genuine I am in my story, and that it's been super helpful for me. Cluster headache for me is not resolved, but I don't get them anymore. And I believe I'm doing myself a great favor in terms of protecting myself from a variety of other illnesses as well in my daily supplementation regimen. But in terms of what other people have said, well, I can tell you I have personally helped a number of New Zealanders through the journey, and they were in a similar place to myself. You know, I recall one guy, Jason, he's a really good rooster from the Waikato. I said, just drive up and see me, you know, like, drive up and I'll help you. Again, it's really hard to talk about this stuff. And again, this disheveled guy turned up on my doorstep and it's like, here, just take these and no more cluster headache. The same thing with a gentleman by the name of Rob. He owns a barbershop down at Napier, a really good Maori dude. You know, and I remember when he joined a couple of years ago, him and his partner were just in that same spot of despair, right? And again, I took the time to explain how it works, got him on the regimen, his attack stopped. I've since had so many messages from people just reaching out on various platforms to say, you know, my husband, my wife, my son, my daughter, 20 years, 15 years, 10 years, we just want to reach out and say thank you. And it's just like, how do people not know about this? In terms of my own personal connection with it and talking to the element of migraine sufferers out there that may be watching and wondering, does it work for migraine as well? Pete says it does. And I can tell you a story. My father died when I was actually before I was born. I never met him and I never had a relationship with my uncle, who is now in his late 80s. And I recently went and saw him and introduced myself. And, you know, that was a real spiritual thing for me to do. But, you know, I said, you know, are you married, Ian? And he said, yeah, you know, I've got my wife's married. She's, you know, she's downstairs. I said, oh, you know, can I, you know, where is she? Bring her up. I want to meet her. And he said, oh, you know, look, mate, she gets really bad migraines. She, you know, she doesn't come out of her room when she's getting them. I said, oh, you know, that's really sad. You know, how long's, and he said, you know, she's been dealing with daily migraine for 25 years. And I said, Ian, you know, the vitamin D, and it's the same look everyone gives you, like you're selling them snake oil. And it's like, Ian, I'm not even trying to sell it to you. I don't sell vitamin D. Like, I do not sell vitamin D. And he's a smart guy, even though he's approaching 19. I explained it to him. I said, Ian, I'm just going to order it and I'm going to send it to you. And just, you know, get her to follow this and take it for a week. And if it doesn't work, just forget about it, right? You will have wasted nothing. It's very safe. Just go for it. And so I got on iHerb. I actually ordered the cheapest of the cheap stuff. I sent it to their house and I get this call a week later. It's my uncle. And he's like, Craig, what can we give you? She's had migraine for 25 years and she's tried everything. She takes triptans every single day. Her headaches have stopped. He's quite a dry human old guy, and he said the only headache now she gets is, you know, she's not winning at the pokies, which is really bad. But, you know, it was his way of making light of the situation, and he's just like, what can I give you to say thanks? It's just like, nothing. I don't want anything. I'm just happy that she's okay, that she can come outside, that she can start living her life again. It's just like, I cannot believe it. anyway, it really is touching stuff to suffer and then not suffer because of a fucking vitamin. You know, like, what the fuck? So hard. It's so hard to convey the feeling I have when society just doesn't know. It's like we're talking about the oldest hormone on planet Earth, vitamin D, and enabled our fucking sea-bound ancestors to leave the sea and develop on land to mineralize calcium, for fuck's sake. And we could, it makes me so sad for where we're at as humans to be in this position where we fucking don't know. It's so natural, yet we're so ashamed of our bodies. We're so scared of the fucking sun. We're sunscreen. It's like, you fucking idiots. What other animal on earth, what other insect on earth? Tell me, what other fucking animal, insect, bird, reptile, fish on earth is covered in fucking clothes, you know, and blocking out their ability to produce a fucking hormone? It's so dumb. It's so dumb. Anyway, I'm sorry to have gone off on a tangent there. It's just really, really difficult once you get it to just put up with the fact that there's so much ignorance out there. Anyway, efficacy, it fucking works. In terms of feedback, others say it works. It's not just me. In terms of recommended reading and follow-up, like, you need to spend the hour or two watching Stasia Gobnik's keynote. This is the smartest lady on the planet. Like, she blows me away. Her research papers that have been published, they're on PubMed. Go and look them up. But Stasia Gobnik is breaking the veil on vitamin D3 serum, the gut microbiome, vitamin B synthesis, the sleep centers and reptilian brain, and the human ability to heal itself while it's asleep. It's fascinating stuff. I've got the link down below. Feel free to check it out. There is a book, Judson Somerville, Dr. Judson Somerville. This is another one of life's beautiful people right here. Good dude, like, really good guy. You have to read his book, The Optimal Dose. There are some bombshells in that book, some language that is just so plain and eloquent, the veil will lift and you will understand, even if you're not an endocrinologist. I've put the thing up on the video. Just go and see it. There is a dude making medical lectures, and he made one on COVID-19 and vitamin D just to illustrate the science for guys like me who are not scientists to be able to understand this ancient hormone and how it relates to vitamin D. Again, he's only showing the literature. That's Ninja Nerd Lectures side by side, and I'll put the link below. In terms of support, if you're a Kiwi or an Aussie, get on Facebook. There is a New Zealand Australia cluster headache support group, and there are a lot of good people there on there, and there are a number of other ones for the international people that may be watching, and that is Cluster Headache Community and Cluster Headaches, and again, side by side, I've got the screen shots up there, and I'll put the links below. In terms of an old school website where you may be very lucky enough to catch Batch and ask him a personal question about the vitamin D regimen, or simply log in to say thank you, Pete, clusterheadaches.com. And so that's a great site there with some good information that spans the years of Pete responding to people that have questions and explaining the science. That's where I first got the look-see before venturing onto the Vitamin D Wiki, which is where there is just a wealth of knowledge to all things vitamin D. I'm just going to scroll the list for you right now, and you can see from A to Z that it is just unbelievable that we haven't heard more about this. And it was only through suffering that I found it. So that's the recommended reading and follow-up. That's where you go to get the lowdown and the information. In terms of technical discussion, I'm not going to include it in this video. I really just wanted this to be my personal story and explaining how to take the regimen. But I will make a more scientific presentation to talk about how vitamin D3 and its cofactors work in terms of cluster headache and migraine. Discuss, you know, the vitamin D binding protein, hydroxylation of vitamin D in the liver and kidney, the vitamin D receptor, the retinoid X receptor and the process of heterodimerization, the vitamin D response elements in DNA, and then, of course, move on to talk and explain the genetic transcription and regulation of mRNA in relation to the neuropeptides that cause cluster headache and migraine, ribosomal expression, and then trigeminal activation, which results in the headache that you and I know. There's a lot of science there, and I look forward to going into it because I nerd out on that stuff, and so I'll do that over the coming little while. But that's where it's at. I from the bottom of my heart, if you're suffering, I wish you the best. This presentation comes from here. I don't want anything from you. You know, I want you to be well. I want you to be able to live and love. And I know what you're coming through. And it's just like vitamins, these things really work.